Welcome back to the show, everyone. My name is Mike. This is Jim. This is from Practice Execution, and we're both feeling good. We had Penny's for lunch today, which is by far the number one lunch choice at the Tasty Works Nation.
It is.
Yeah.
It is.
For sure. Hands down.
No question. But I had to be a little careful, because Asian food is one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. And as I shared with you earlier, today's an exciting day for me, because I am going to do my next bodybuilding show on March 25th.
Nice.
In 13 and a half weeks.
Yes.
And so it's kind of funny because my son is due on March 31st. This is kind of tricky. Everyone has their own way of nesting, right? Yeah. So my wife, she nests by getting the house ready and doing all these different things. Mm-hmm. The last bodybuilding show I did was in October of 2014, which was 2 months before Penelope was born. So I nest by doing bodybuilding shows. And thankfully, I have the most supportive wife in the world. And she just said, I am totally behind you unless I go into labor. Then your competition training comes to a screeching halt.
Yeah.
And you will be by my side, which of course I will.
Absolutely. That's exciting, though.
It is.
13 and a half weeks is a long time, but still, to be at peak condition, you got to do slow and steady.
Can't do the crash cuts. It's going to be interesting.
Yeah.
It's going to be interesting. So actually, I've got a quick story for the viewers out here. Quick story, because, and you guys will know this when I say this, shared this with you the other night at the Christmas party. So, when I'm doing a segment, when everyone's doing a segment, they have their go-to moves, right? They have their moves that they just, when they really want to make a point, like this is what they use, mm-hmm. right? For me, it's kind of one of these, mm-hmm. and I'll drop one of these on people.
Yep.
For you, it's this motion right here. It's this guy right here. You guys will see it today. Watch. Just watch him do it kind of subconsciously.
Yeah.
But I have a history with that very motion. So speaking of bodybuilding, I did my first bodybuilding show in March of 2001. I was 19 years old, right? And I trained for 4 months, whatever. Had no idea what to expect. And I felt, man, I was on top of the world. I was cocky. I went in there, I'm like, oh, I might take second at worst, but I'm taking this whole thing down,
yeah.
right? I walked in there. I got up on stage. There were 9 guys in my class. Mm-hmm. It was me and 8 other dudes. And I got completely embarrassed. Like, I finished dead last, and it wasn't even close. It was like they just called some guy out of the crowd, and they're like, yo, man, we need one more guy. Can you do it? Like, it looked like I hadn't even been training,
That's
right?
That's awesome.
But here's the best part. So if you're familiar with bodybuilding, one of the things you get to do is you get to do your own posing routine
right.
to music, mm-hmm. 60, 90 seconds.
Yep.
Well, in bodybuilding, they have a most muscular pose, right? And the classic ones are kind of this motion,
yeah.
or you got your hands on your hips motion, right?
Yeah.
Well, I was up on stage to my song, to the routine that I had practiced over and over again. And I got to the climax of my routine, my most muscular pose, and I totally panicked, and I did this. And it wasn't even playing. And I looked back at the tape, I'm like, why did I do that?
I totally panicked.
Yeah. So every single time you do that on the show, I think of that moment, and I can't help but smile, even though it was one of the most embarrassing moments of my life.
Yeah, I mean, when you're on stage nervous like that, sometimes you just black out, and you don't know what you're doing. So.
That's it, man. That's it.
That's good, though.
Yeah.
It's a good pose.
So, yeah.
So what do we got today?
We got ratio spreads.
Ratio spreads.
Let's talk about some ratio spreads. You know, we kind of alluded to this yesterday, mm-hmm. and I thought, let's talk about ratio spreads. Let's kind of talk about the power behind the ratio spread, and, you know, just kind of see where it takes us.
Yeah, I like them a lot. So we've got the trade page loaded, and we've got SPY loaded. And basically, if we talk, yesterday we talked about a Super Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
And a ratio spread is very similar in the sense that we're financing a long spread by selling an additional short option against that long spread. Mm-hmm. But just the construction of the trade itself is a little bit different. So a Super Bowl is something where you sell a put to finance the purchase of a call spread, where a ratio spread would be using the same instrument. So I would mm-hmm. be buying a long put spread and selling an additional short put on the same short strike as that long put spread.
Mm-hmm.
So it gives us an interesting situation where we're kind of bullish, bearish, neutral.
Right, yeah, right. We've talked about this before.
Yeah.
The deltas on a ratio spread is so interesting because if you do kind of... Yeah, I hate to call it classic, but I would say kind of our classic ratio spread is going to be using put options
mm-hmm.
because it allows us to capture that volatility skew more efficiently than a call ratio spread would. But there's nothing wrong with a call ratio spread. But I think we all tend to gravitate more to the put side. But the actual deltas when you put that guy on are going to be positive upon trade origination because of that extra short put that you've sold. So the bullish deltas from the short puts are going to overpower the bearish deltas from the one long put that you have.
Right.
But if the market starts to move in your favor, which in this scenario is down, your deltas actually become negative.
Yeah. And that's because if you just remember that we have a long put spread at the very core and then a short put, an additional short put on the same strike, which is what I've constructed here by just setting up a long put vertical and then double clicking on the short put medallion and just changing the contracts to two, you can clearly see now I have a ratio spread. So when I have a ratio spread, I have a different number of contracts for the same amount of contracts that I'm purchasing. So a ratio could be a 2x1, 3x2, whatever that is. It just means that you have a different number of contracts that you're selling compared to the ones that you're buying. And one of the benefits of a ratio spread, which is something that I really like, is not only the fact that we can be pretty profitable in the situation where we pin the short strike, because that would be our max profit zone, because of the fact that if SPY comes down to 225 at expiration, my long put spread, which is $1 wide here, if I set it up as a 226, 225 long put spread, would be at max profit. And my two short puts would be worthless. So I would be left with a long put that would be worth $1, meaning this total credit, which is a big credit of $3.03, would be my profitability on the short side of it, but also I would be able to sell out of my long put at 226 for another dollar. So my max profit here is actually 403 compared to 303.
It's going
to
be the credit you collect when you put the trade on plus the width of the long debit spread.
Yeah, and one of the biggest benefits of ratio spreads and using ratio spreads to become long stock, which is something I've talked about with Ryan a bunch of times, is that you have a break even that is super low. And that's because, again, we have a long spread that is going to help us move that break even further. So with a normal short put spread, let's just say I bring it down to like 223 for my long put and 220 for my short put. If I were to just have one short put, so if I know that my short put spread or my short put is worth $2, if I just sold a put at 220, I know that my break even would be right around 218. If I sell a put for $2, I'm collecting a $2 credit, and I can use that credit to adjust my break even past my short strike, which would be my break even, so about 218. But what you see here is that with a ratio spread, my break even is really just the conjunction of where my profit stops and my losses begin. You can see it's all the way down to 215. And that's because of the fact that not only would I be collecting a credit for this overall position, so $1.40 for the overall position, but if the underlying moves down, if I have a $3 wide long put spread, that's going to be used as profit from that spread that I can then use to move my break even further. So I can take this $1.40 credit, move it to adjust my break even on the downside from 220 to 218.60, but then also take another $3 below that and bring me down to 215.60.
It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful thing. And it's, again, just another great example of, hey, Jim, hey, Mike, I like what you guys are talking about, man, but I just want to play the upside in the market over time. I just want to play the positive drift.
Right.
The market always goes up, at least over the last 9 years. I don't think we've had a down day.
Right.
So I want to play that. That's how I want to position my portfolio. By all means, that sounds like a great strategy.
Yeah.
Sell a put, or better yet, maybe put on a ratio spread to improve your break-even point even better. So you don't have to just buy stock and be done with it. There are better, more strategic ways for you to accomplish that same objective.
Yeah, it's
another
absolutely
great example of how to do that.
Definitely, and especially with strategies like this, this is why I like strategies like ratio spreads and broken wing butterflies, is that whenever we can give ourselves more ways to be successful or more outs in the sense of giving ourselves a wider break even or a better break even, or even just another way to be successful, like that's the reason why we like selling premium. We like selling premium because it gives us another dimension outside of directionality and outside of theta. If implied volatility contracts, we have the ability to close that trade out for a profit as well. But when I look at a trade like this, not only do I have a very nice break even, but if the stock price, if I'm lucky enough to pin that stock price at expiration right around 220, I'm going to see a nice big profit over my credit that I am initially receiving. Mm-hmm. And if I actually don't see any movement at all, if it stays right here at 226, that $1.40 credit would be my profitability as well. If SPY goes up, same situation, $1.40 becomes my profitability. So it's just a matter of understanding what you're doing with the trade and what you're offsetting to give yourself that lower break even and give yourself that higher profitability. If I were to just sell this put, it would give me a credit of $2, which is 60 cents more than this $1.40. Mm-hmm. So that's the trade-off.
That's the trade-off. There's always a trade-off.
Right.
There's always something that needs to be exchanged for something else. But the beauty of the ratio spread, and you kind of hit on this before, and I think a great way to close this out, is you see we're buying a put spread, we're playing direction, mm-hmm. but we're paying for it with another option.
Right.
It's all about cost basis reduction. If you see almost every single thing that we do, the only time that we don't is maybe earnings, we're playing an at-the-money directional play, and then that's it. Right? We're not really trying to reduce basis. But with Super Bulls, with ratio spreads, with broken wing butterflies, with even a straight strangle, right? Bringing that premium in, we're always looking to improve our probabilities by reducing that basis. Exact same thing going on here.
Yeah, and that's why you've got such a high pop and such a big range to be profitable.
That's all there is to it.
That's it. Ratio spreads. Love
easy,
it.
Easy enough.
Thanks so much for tuning in. My name is Mike. This is Jim. If you want to follow us on Twitter, I'm at Tastytrader Mike. He's Jay Schultz FF. Shadow Traders are coming up next, though, so stay tuned.
See you guys tomorrow.